What's the difference between sex and gender, and why does it matter? In this lecture, I'll give you some background to this distinction, why it's important, and how it's opened up a variety of ways of understanding gender and sexuality in society. In everyday language, people often use the terms sex and gender interchangeably. However, in sociology and other social sciences, the terms have more specialized meanings. The term sex refers to biological differences, including those of anatomy and physiology, between males, females, and intersex people. Approximately 99.6% of all human beings are born biologically male or female. The other 0.4% of births are those of intersex people or hermaphrodites. They have the anatomical characteristics of both sexes or indeterminate genitalia. The term gender, on the other hand, refers to the social and culturally created understandings, expectations, and norms which relate to sex differences. Gender refers to what masculinity or femininity means in a society, how that's internalized and constructed as identity. It refers to how that relates to the lived experience of being and having a certain sort of body and how it sets up expectations about how to behave or relate to other people in a range of different contexts. Gender was once assumed to be largely a natural extension of a person's biological sex. That is, it was assumed that a person's male or female body would largely determine their identity, the kind of person they would be, and how they would develop. The role of culture and socialization was seen as operating within these constraints and simply affecting how someone might express or repress these biologically based tendencies. However, research from a number of disciplines has challenged this kind of thinking. For example, research in psychology has shown that biological sex does not always correspond to gender identity. Someone who has a male body might identify as a woman, while someone with a female body might identify as a man. The French feminist philosopher Simone de Beauvoir famously wrote that one is not born, but rather becomes a woman. The corollary is, of course, that one is not born, but rather becomes a man. So the process of becoming a woman or man is not a fixed one. It can take many paths through different contexts with various conflicts, ambiguities, and choices along the way. A number of other feminist writers, including Nancy Chodorow and Juliet Mitchell, have pointed out that Sigmund Freud's psychoanalytic theory is primarily a theory of how femininity and masculinity emerge within a particular structuring of interpersonal relations. From this perspective, psychoanalytic theory and feminist philosophy agree that women and men are made but not born. In other words, biology alone doesn't explain sexual orientation or gender personality. Similarly, historians have shown how the meaning and boundaries of gender difference have changed over time. For example, in the 20th century, women who had been excluded on gender grounds from what were thought of as male jobs in manufacturing industry were encouraged to do those jobs when men were away fighting in the Second World War. Anthropological research has also shown how gender can vary quite considerably across different societies, even when human biology is fundamentally similar around the world. In one famous study, Sex and Temperament in Three Primitive Societies, published in 1935, the anthropologist Margaret Mead found substantial gender variation among three small societies she studied in New Guinea. Among the mountain-dwelling Arapesh, she found both men and women approximated to what Westerners would think of as feminine. Both men and women were brought up to be cooperative, responsive to the needs of other people, and unaggressive. She also found no evidence that people were powerfully driven by their sexual inclinations. The Arapesh ideal was of a mild, responsive man married to a mild, responsive woman. Among the river-dwelling Mundugamore, she found both men and women approximated to what Westerners would think of as masculine. Both men and women were brought up to be aggressive, ruthless, and highly sexed. Their cultural ideal was that of a violent, aggressive man married to a violent, aggressive woman. Among the lake-dwelling Chambuli, Mead found that men and women approximated to a reversal of typical Western notions of gender. Women in this society were brought up to be dominant, assertive, and highly sexed, while men were brought up to be foppish, emotionally dependent, and coquettish. The Chambuli cultural ideal was that men's and women's personalities should oppose and complement each other. As researchers from different disciplines produced new research findings about gender, it changed the way gender was understood and opened up new questions for social scientists. For example, if gender is seen not just as a personal property or as a product of biology, then it can be viewed in other ways, such as a social fact, a set of cultural meanings, a form of social structure, or a social and historical process. Let's consider each of these in turn. First, Gender can be viewed not just as an individual property, but as an important social fact in Emile Durkheim's sense of being external, constraining, and general in society. According to Durkheim, people are born into societies where beliefs, norms, and practices already exist, including those relating to gender. This means they're not created by each newly arriving individual anew, they have an existence independent of particular individuals. Social facts like gender also constrain people. When people agree with and conform to gender norms, they don't usually notice their constraint. However, when people try to ignore gender norms or act against them, then they can feel their coercive power and resistance. For example, if people dress, speak, or act in ways that violate gender norms, then they can face sanctions for non-conformity. Social facts like gender are not confined to one small corner of society, but operate across society in many different contexts. Second, gender can be viewed as an important set of cultural meanings. These meanings are related to the physical and reproductive differences between the sexes. However, these meanings define, categorize, represent, prescribe, and proscribe the character, expectations, limits, and possibilities of gendered existence. Culture can express sex differences in terms of biological capacities. It can emphasize them, such as with clothes, makeup, or exercise. It can deny them, such as in dress, employment, or politics. It can problematize them, such as through people who define themselves as a third gender. Or it can mythologize them, such as in literature, film, or computer games. Third, gender can be viewed as a form of social structure which organizes relationships between men and women throughout society, governs their practices, and allocates rewards, opportunities, and recognition to them. In most societies, men are advantaged over women, and older men are usually advantaged over younger men, women, and children. Social theorists use different terms for gender as a social structure, including the sex-gender system, the gender order, or patriarchy. The latter term originally meant the rule of the father over a family, household, or tribe, but it's been used more generally to refer to male-dominated societies. Fourth, gender can be viewed as a social and historical process through which people actively construct, contest, and change gender in circumstances which are not of their own making. The women's movement, for example, has played a key role in winning freedom and equality for women in a number of areas, including the right to vote, to work, to own property, and to be educated, as well as for equal pay, sexual liberation, and access to safe and effective contraception. In summary, first, while the terms sex and gender are often used interchangeably in everyday language, they have more specialized meanings in sociology. Second, sex refers to the biological differences between men, women, and intersex people, while gender refers to the social and cultural dimensions of being a sexed person. Third, gender was once thought to be the product of a person's biological sex, but research in a number of disciplines has shown how gender can change and differ from biological sex. Fourth, the understanding that gender is socially constructed means that it can be viewed not just as an individual property, but as a social fact, a set of cultural meanings, a form of social structure, and as a social and historical process.